Shimazo. Shikuhongo Uemazo. Ushimazo.
Alright, we're going to start first. Sacred art and healing practice, ritualized body performance art. Thank you.
Hi everyone.
Hey.
Hello.
I'm happy to be here, and I thank Kai for inviting me to present the conference and to be part of this conversation and share with you my work. I finished my PhD 2013 at Cornell University, so I've been doing and creating performances, and my presentation today is sacred art and healing practice, ritualizing body and performance. But my background is actually making performances, and in my presentation I'm gonna try to show you my work, how the trajectories of how I started making performances, my influences. I'm actually gonna, for this presentation, I'm gonna start by looking at the overview of the presentation. I'm gonna start by looking at my research background. I'm gonna look at after independence in Angola, growing up in Rwanda, Angola, the influences I had. Sorry?
Can
you hear me?
Speak up.
Can you hear me now?
No, you're not speaking any louder.
That's as loud as I can go. and I'm going to be looking at the literary background for those who are interested to look more on the papers and the books that have been influencing my work. I'm going to be looking at diaspora cultural influence in London. I'm going to be looking at the voodoo in Haiti as a primary influence of my work. And the four main artists and literary critics that as a diaspora influence, mainly people that blacks from America that looked at the voodoo as a way to reinforce their identity. I'm going to be looking at the influence of Nigeria, because my background has been from Angola, I kind of have this Luso Africa perspective. And after my arrival in London, I came as a refugee because of the war in Angola. And because of my background, I was displaced. I felt that I didn't have the sense of identity. And Nigeria was one of the cultures that I look at as a way to ground myself, because of the number of Nigerians in the diaspora and the body of work that Nigerian people are producing. So I gravitated to that as a reference. Many scholars, many writers that I look up to are from Nigeria. And in this context, I'm going to be talking about Fela Kuti and Rotimi Fanikeyod, and I'm going to end with showing you images of my work. So I'm basically going to be looking at, based my presentation on talking about and showing images and using photography as a way to demonstrate and narrate our history, and as a way to help us to understanding and recreating our identity through photography. So my research background actually started because of after I arrived in London, as I mentioned, I felt that I was displaced. I was a refugee. I didn't know how to speak English. I felt that I didn't know who I was. So I, in order for me to reinvent my identity, I start making performances and looking at ways of reinventing my identity. And one of the ways that I felt to express it, it was through creating performances and reconnecting with my identity in Africa and Angola in particular, as a way to regulating myself because of the situation I was in the context of being in London. So I was deeply affected by the war because of in Angola after the independence in 1975, the country embarked into devastating civil war, and because of the war, I was affected. And the war was actually created by these three leaders of the nationalist parties. They, after independence, they disagreed, they didn't have any agreement in terms of leadership of the country. And because the natural resources of the country, they wanted to grab and control the power. Because of that, the country went into a war. And as a result of the war, I ended up in Britain. So as I was displaced in Britain, I was traumatized and I was affected by the trauma of growing up in a country where there was a very insecure and persecutions and killing people, and you know, and these three leaders are the main people that were created the instability in the country, as well as the. Because Angola is one of the countries that was right in the middle of the Cold War, because of the mineral resources and the wealth of the country, the West and the superpower countries wanted to grab the resources, and the leaders, they were divided and affected by the Western power. So in London, I began to validate and began to look at the value of culture. So I realized the influences that I had growing up in Rwanda, and how the influences of because Angola has many different ethnic groups, and I was I grew up having neighbors and friends that came from a rural parts of the country, and they brought with them you know, traditions and music and dance and ways of dressing, as well as the carnival. The carnival in Rwanda is one of the popular carnival in Africa, and I grew up seeing and witnessing the traditions of carnival. And in London, I started to using memory as a way to reconnect it and gain an understanding of the self. So one of the tribes in Angola that became a very close reference for my work is the Choma tribe, and they their tradition became a way for me to find the ways of reconnecting and find the relationship in terms of recreating that diasporic identity. So for those interested to go and further and look at the Angolan issue, this is some of the literary work that talks about the history of Angola and the impact of the war and the some of the reasons behind the war, and why Angola matters actually goes in details about one of the problems of the three different ethnic groups in the country that was involved in the war is because one of the leaders actually came from the island, the Santorini Island, and he became the leader of the party, and the other parties didn't, and then he became the president of the country. And some of the political leaders of the other parties didn't agree with the fact that the leader, the president actually was in Angolan born. So this was one of the main reasons of the conflict in the country. And then this book actually goes in details. So in London, I was very much part of the diaspora. And as a diaspora, I look as a ways of wanting to be part of the diaspora and find my identity and contribute in terms of being from Luso Africa. And I began to look at voodoo in Haiti as a way of black religion, because of you know, as a black diaspora, black Atlantic, blacks that are more affected from the slave trade, we recreated a religion, and voodoo. I look at particularly to voodoo, because voodoo is one of the religions in the diaspora that links directly to Africa, and I began to look at ways of identifying myself in terms of religion and spirituality, and because voodoo as well it connected with Congo and Angola, as well as Nigeria and Benin, but Congo, because Haiti, voodoo Haiti, they speak French, and it was a French colony, and there is a direct relation with Congo and Angola. And Angola considered as one of the countries in Africa that actually most of the majority of slaves actually came from Angola. Came from Angola in terms of they came out from Angola, but they from Congo, Angola, Zambia, and Zimbabwe. So Angola actually has a, but because of the fact that in the Anglophone world, the Angola as a Lusophone tend not to to be exposed and to be in the main discussion. So this type of information doesn't really come to awareness of people. So I began to look at the works of Erol Josué, which is a Haitian priest. He lived in France and now he lives in the US. And he is a musician and he's a dancer. I particularly look at his work because of the fact that he's exploring rituals and reconnecting to African traditions of spirituality and African cosmology, and his work tends to for my practice, I use as one of the primary influences. I look at the works of Catherine Durham and Maya Durain. Catherine Durham is an African American dancer, for those who don't know. She is one of the pioneers of black dance. She, as an African American, she looked at the Haiti religion and ways of looking at the world as a way for her to recreate her identity as an African American. And as a pioneer, there is a technique. If you study dance, you actually learn Catherine Durham technique, the secret technique of black dance as a way of reinforcing and giving a perspective of black dance. And Maya Deren, also, she's a Jew American who went to Haiti, and she created a DVD where she recorded a voodoo ritual in Haiti, and her work if you look at the traditions of Haiti. Zora Neale Hurston is a literary critic and folklore, an African-American who look at the ways of reinventing the black identity to ethnographic work and in terms of anthropology. She also traveled to Haiti and Jamaica as a way of understanding and linking with the Caribbean as well as Africa. And through her work, she wanted to emphasize and giving value to the black identity and the black ways of looking at the world and reimagining and recreating an identity that is a common in terms of blackness. So she produces a very important literary works. For those who are interested, some of her work is in my reference, my biography at the end. So I looked at Nigeria, as we know, Nigeria is the most populated black country in Africa. And because of that, Nigeria has a very strong
production, cultural
production in Nigeria and in the diaspora. So I looked at Nigeria as a way to understand their methodology in terms of ways of an expression of cultural identity. And Fela Kuti is, as we all know, a musician and the person who fought the politics through music and through ways of expressing freedom for blackness and Africa. So his work became an important ways of representing blackness and showing us the beauty of the black body. And but in his work, I became more interested in his work more because of the fact that he was a musician and a person who used the rituals, who worshipped the black gods and who valued the black ancestors. And he created the rituals and ceremonies, and he was doing divinations and worshipping and valuing the ancestors of Africa, and looking at ways of validating our leaders such as Marcus Garvey, Martin Luther King, and Malcolm X. So another person that I use as a reference is Rotumi Fanikeyod, who is a Nigerian photographer who lived in London during the 80s, living in America as well. He explored black body, the black male body. Although he was contextualized because of the fact that he was a black gay man, and he, you know, during the 80s, he was very much challenged because of his sexuality, but he wanted to, through using the black male body in the studio, he wanted to reconnect with Nigeria, and he was exploring representation of the black body through using religion, the iconography of Yoruba. So he demonstrated to us ways of worshipping and venerating our ancestors and reconnecting with black spirituality. So this is another work, another pieces of his exploration in the studio. And I'm going to end with some of my work that I've been making since the early 2000s. I've been, actually for this presentation, three performances that I'm going to show, that I actually did in a park. So I did the personal exploration in the park using body painting. So I tend to explore the body and looking at specific site-specific spaces and using props and connecting with nature and explore the body and to also emphasize the fact of the beauty of the black body, the beauty and the ways of expressing in terms of art and artistic identity. So this one was at the Hackney Park Cemetery in London. So I explore and look at ways of representing the body and recreating the self. So this is just images that I create as a way of us think of ways of representing, reimagining, and recreating the black identity and black ways of reconnecting with our ancestors and in terms of identity. So this one was at the Brockwell Park that I wanted to see ways of presenting the body in a manner that expressing ways of venerating our ancestors. So this was a collaboration that I did with two Nigerian girls, and we wanted to see how can we have an encounter and interpret the body and in terms of spirituality and ways of blackness. So I'm going to end with my references for those who would like to know further.
So we've got two speakers in here. Should we do the second speaker as well and then do questions together? Yeah?
We'll do the next speaker.
Okay.
Should I stay here or?
No, come on. And then we'll come and go back up for the next we have